began to kind of realize it's like having an adventure muscle, that if you use the muscle, it tends to kind of shrivel a bit. And that was what I was feeling when I came back from Canberra, was I was like, oh my God, this muscle is not being used and it's not strong enough. And so it really took me quite a number of years of just chipping away and exposing myself to that terrain gently at first, and then further and further afield to kind of really strengthen that adventure muscle and gain the confidence again to run in Tassie.
Kia ora tato, that was Hanny Allston. I'm Matt Raymond.
And I'm Eugene Bingham.
And this is Dirt Church Radio. Interesting conversations with interesting runners.
At Kepler in Te Anau, there is going to be a confluence of the greatest legs and minds in all of trail running, and also wild things are going to be there. So those
Mal
of you...
Mal and Sally are going to be there?
Mal and Sally are going to be there at the hall.
Yep.
They're going to be slinging some merch. They're going to be chatting. They're going to be signing people up to wild things. And
if you use the code...
Yeah, DCR 2020.
You get 15 months for the price of 12 months on Wild Things VIP membership. Mm-hmm. And they give us a little bit of a scratch.
Yeah.
And it's... It's
so,
all good.
So what we're going to get at Kepler?
Yeah.
We're going to just sit there and our
lay on my back.
And scratch from Mal and our tummies.
I'll scratch my tummy.
Yeah.
Anyway,
yep.
Also...
They'll be there. Also...
Speaking of pleasing scratches, is Further Faster going to be there? Selling all the montane gear that you could hope to get your hands on. Aotearoa's best independent outdoors store, furtherfaster.co.nz.
Or in the flesh.
Or in the flesh, just go there and hang out, high five, gaze and wonder at Jacob, and get amongst it. Also, Grant Guys and his many brands will be there. Scott Running, and we have it on good authority that there's going to be shoes there.
Yes.
The Kinabalu Ultra RC, which we're both running in. Course watches, Ultra Spy packs. We've been very, very happy. And Jolbo sunglasses.
I'm doing sunglasses.
Yeah, he's doing sort of sunglasses. He's interpreting sunglasses because it's dark. But if you go, come down to Kepler, hang out with us. We're going to be there. We're going to be slinging some merch as well.
I am excited that the Scott shoes are going to be there because, you know, it's been hard to get hold of them.
Absolutely.
Sometimes.
Yeah.
And but they're going to be there in force.
That's right.
Yeah.
Black and yellow.
Mm.
Anyway.
Traction matters.
Get into it.
It goes something like further, faster, there in Christchurch. Rocky is hairy and so is Badger. Jules is nice and Jack is delicious. Go to further, faster now.
Oh, further, faster, there in Christchurch. Rocky is hairy and so is Badger. Jules is nice and Jack is delicious. Go to further, faster now.
Here we are, divided by fate and responsibility of Eugene Bingham, who's experiencing a mild cold. And
well, episode 121, we made it, and I didn't want to risk passing on to Matt a potential cold. I just woke up with a bit of a sniffle, and I thought, oh, I don't want Matt coming over and me breathing on him and potentially passing on a cold the week of Kepler. So I said, can we do it remotely? Because we know how to do that.
Did you get a test?
No, I should just go and get a cotton bud.
Well, it's got to have the microchip in it. That's why they have to put it in so long.
Right.
So they implant the microchip into your brainstem.
But
that, which is a my flippant comment is a symptom of taper madness.
Well, that's
which
true.
Is
that's true.
What I'm experiencing.
Hey, sorry, I was thinking in the nighttime because I was worried about this. You see, I was thinking in the night. Imagine if they had a tracing app. Genomic testing and the old contact traces for colds. That'd be quite amazing.
No one would ever leave the house. But
that's true. Anyway, yes, tape madness, always tough. It's in some ways it's tougher than the actual big training block week, same.
Absolutely, like 100% tougher because at least when you're doing big training blocks, you feel all in the endorphins are really flowing and you kind of... If you've got a sense of progression and you know, but it's good to to also think about the process and, really looking forward to going away.
Mm. So, yeah, Kepler on this weekend. And we've got our live show as well. So,
yep, absolutely. Yeah,
don't forget to come on down.
Yeah, well, come on up because we'll be upstairs at the Fiordland Event Centre.
Yeah.
I'd like to say. Community Event Centre in Te Anau. Mm. And we'll be speaking with a couple of incredible guests, including Scotty Hawker and Fiona Love, and it'll be great to see you there.
Yeah, yeah. So that's roll on up, Friday, roll December 4. Yeah, roll up, roll up. Like you say, we are going to have we're going to have some stuff there.
We are going to have some merch to sell as well.
Woohoo!
Come and check it out.
Mm.
Pretty special.
We should put that up on socials beforehand so people can have a look.
Absolutely.
Yeah, man, your chat last week with Marcus.
Yeah,
Torgabi. Did I say it right?
Yes, you did. Yeah, Marcus Torgabi. Yeah,
what an incredible guy.
Yeah, really great. Hey, and amazing too that he, the whole way through and before, he said, "Look, my English isn't so good."
Oh yeah.
And his English was probably better than mine, and certainly better than my Swedish.
It was perfect.
Just incredible.
Yeah.
And lots of people have sort of talked about how it scratches quite an itch within us, eh?
Yeah. 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 I texted you after listening last week, and I'd said I'd come home, run inside, and wanted to do something wild, so I lit the fire.
Yeah.
It was about 20 degrees at the time, so maybe not the best idea, but I hadn't really. But he certainly was inspiring.
And humid too. I thought actually that you had, because you'd been for a ride, I thought you, I literally took you at your word because it was kind of cold. So I thought that you actually did light the fire. But you could have always put the, you could have always put the heat pump on.
That's right. That's right. I've really gone to the wild. I've put the heat pump on. Yeah.
I guess, in my insulated house. And I guess the thing is, and I took his book, it's interesting, I took his book to work the next day or on the Thursday actually.
Mm.
And because I was teaching a course and it was talking about people's risk tolerance.
Mm.
And I just sort of held the book up at one point and I said, look, everyone's got their different risk tolerance, and sort of highlighted that this guy had moved to the Arctic, you know, lived in a tent for 4 years in the Arctic Circle, and made the point that everyone's got their own idea of risk.
Yeah.
But, and risk is inescapable in life, and it's something that we need to kind of embrace to a certain extent.
Yeah. I watched over a couple of sessions, John Kelly's attempt at the Great Round. The Grand, is it called the Grand Round?
The Grand Round, yeah.
On that doco, I've forgotten the name of. God damn, I should have done.
Is it totally FKT'd? No, it's called Grand Round.
I think it's called Grand Round. Yeah.
Yeah.
Talking about pushing your limits. Wow. It's remarkable.
I have to watch that.
Yeah. So the three rounds, one in Wales, England, Scotland, and riding in between them.
Amazing.
That's
really, really amazing. Mm. And speaking of, I mean, you spoke to a really amazing and interesting runner just before.
Yeah, I did. I sort of almost just got off the line with her, Hanny Allston, based in Tasmania, but sort of adopted Kiwi, really. She spent a bit of time living here. Nice. Former world champion orienteer, both senior and junior, which I don't think has been done since. Certainly not by a non-European. Trail runner, marathon runner, and author of Finding My Feet, which I've got to say is remarkably raw and powerful as far as memoirs go. And it really delves into topics we don't often talk about, but which we should, including, you know, body image and mental health and a whole bunch of other stuff. So it's a really, it's a pretty frank conversation. And I'm really grateful to have had it. You dealt with her when you were at KTR, Kiwi Trail Runner.
Yeah. I had a couple of, like, I remember I wrote an article about her training for, I want to say it was the 6 foot track marathon or the Buffalo Stampede. And I apologize to Hanny if it's either one of those two races, but I can't remember which one it is. But she still holds, I think, the course record. Mm-hmm. And I also did something because I was absolutely enchanted about the Kanyani Mount Wellington loop that they do from the shop or the Kanyani Mount Wellington loop in Hobart, you know, running up Kanyani, which is the mountain. And I think it's 28K, I want to say. And if you get back into town and then take your Strava or photos into the shop, you get this beautiful patch That's his Kanyani Mount Wellington loop. And yeah, who my friend's brother, Nick White, he designed. So yeah, I was really enchanted with that. And
yeah,
so it's because it's a really beautiful community kind of spirit thing to do.
Yeah, yeah. And we had a chat about that, and she talked about how people come running into the outdoor shop that they've got, her and her husband, and you know, showing off their courses to claim their badges, because there's more than one different loop now that you can do. They've got a whole bunch of them, and they give them great names. Anyway, we talk about all that, so I don't want to give too much away, but yeah, it's a good conversation. So look forward to bringing you that. How have you been, man?
Yeah, man. This this week. I'm thankful that last week happened when it did, so like all the hard work's done and just kind of tapering, because it was one for the books. Ton of stress from work, and I was juggling runs around like that in life that I haven't for in ages, and you know, tapering, and my wife was changing jobs. So yeah, it was a big week, and I actually made the decision to rest on a Saturday instead of running, which I've been doing for the past God knows how many weeks. And it was awesome, because I'd normally really worry about that, you know, missing a session. But then I reflected that I'd done the hard work. What was the payoff for going for an hour run? And and it's actually the first session that I've missed since I've been with Scotty. So, you know, did my last long run yesterday and felt really, really good at the end of it. And I'm really excited for this week, and just puts it into perspective that it is the cherry on top, and it's one little part of the process as well. So I'm absolutely really excited to be going away.
Yeah. I mean, that's such a good decision, Matt. It's, you know, really hard to do sometimes, isn't it? You become a bit obsessed with hitting, you know, getting all those ticks in the box, but yeah, the absolute right thing to do is to rest at this point, you know, especially when you're stressed.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And I guess it's that thing, isn't it? Lots of people talk about sort of controlling what you control.
Yeah.
And I did that, and it was a good decision. So yeah, just really excited to get to hang out with my old mate and go down to Tiana, really.
Nice, nice. Can I come too?
Yeah. What about you, man? How you been?
Yeah, yeah, good, good, good. Suzanne and I got down to Cambridge to visit a friend's art exhibition and catch up with some really good friends, including had a really cool chat with Angus Ross, who is a strength and conditioning coach and former Winter Olympian for bobsleigh.
Wow.
Yeah, he's got some fascinating ideas about challenging accepted norms in training and across all sports. And it was really interesting, isn't it, that although we both come from sort of different spheres of sport, if you like, you know, he's much more strength and sort of explosive sports, and you know, I'm more kind of the endurance side. There's lots that applies across both, eh?
Yeah.
You know?
My first ever job as a registered nurse, there was a junior doctor there who was in the New Zealand Olympic bobsled team, and he was built like a brick shithouse.
Oh, yeah.
Like,
Gus honestly. Gus is a big man.
Yeah.
but all lean. Lean
yeah,
muscle.
There was no fat on the dude. He was just, he was massive. And you think about it, it's just, I guess, it's you're sprinting. And then nearly dying every time.
Yeah. So that was really interesting. And yeah, his wife is Sarah Cowley Ross, who's also an Olympian. So it was good to catch up with them. And I also got a new name.
Yes, I saw that stock. You did.
I did. Yeah. So my name is not the easiest to spell. And so after years of having engine and all sorts of weird spellings, Fungary once. Anyway, for, you know, when you order a coffee and they say, oh, what name? I always just say Scott these days. And I will say, I've said that since before Scott Running started sponsoring Dirt Church Radio. It's not Grant making us change our names. Hey, Scott.
Long black for Ultra.
Do you want another legal letter?
Yeah.
Anyway, so I always just say Scott because it's easy. And I think, how can you stuff that up? Well, somebody did.
Yeah, that's so amazing stock.
I got
it
back and it said stock. STOCK.
Did they say stock?
Yeah. Like, yeah, the guy yelled out, stock.
I was like, nice.
Yeah, that'll be me. Anyway, it did mean that I put it up on Instagram stories, and it did mean that I got lots of funny stories from people of what their names are and how they get messed up.
Yeah.
It's been quite entertaining.
I have a friend whose name is Fleur, and you think that was reasonably easy, but yeah, Fleur gets It should just all be called Matt. It's, even if you get it wrong and put one T instead of two, it's still the same.
How does that ever get messed up?
My last name gets messed up every single time.
Oh, yeah,
but my first name,
you can't mess that up.
Yeah.
Yeah, like you say, one T or two would be the only variation on that. Do you ever throw a tantrum about that?
Oh, I can't go back to Countdown in New Lynn because I got trespass from there. No, I don't.
You've spelled my name wrong.
Yeah, chuck Eliza Minnelli in there. Or a Russell Crowe.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So anyway.
Anyway, so there you go. That was my weekend. And so yeah, got a nice run in down at Cambridge, which was fun, and I like having an explore around a new place. I mean, it wasn't the most adventurous run, I'll grant you that, but I just like to have a look around. You know, it's always fun. It's always fun. You see so much more on foot, don't you, when you're in a new place.
You do.
Yeah. Right. Patreon patrons.
Patreon patrons. Look, we are stoked that we could get down to Kepler, and we couldn't do it without our Patreon patrons. If you'd like to support what we do, we'd love you to come on board, and by setting up a regular donation, even for the cost of a cup of coffee a month or a once-off payment of a cup of coffee, it helps us do things that, you know, are expensive and a little bit outside our reach if we were to be doing it our own, like buying audio equipment, getting to more races to interview people, and it also helps us keep the lights on. So, you know, if you're keen to come on board, we're at patreon.com/dirtchurchradio, and if you're not keen to come on board, well, we're just as pleased that you're here, and thanks for listening.
Yeah. Right.
Stuff you should know.
Okay, stuff you should know. It's a somber one this week. But I thought it was important to talk about. So as we know, a runner unfortunately died at Tarawera this year in the 100 miler. Well, he in fact collapsed near the finish line, and then the doctors and nurses and everyone tried to look after him or save him for 3 days, but he unfortunately passed away in hospital. His family have asked for privacy, and so we're going to respect that.
Mm-hmm.
But I thought it was important to find out. Oh, actually, I became a little bit obsessed with finding out what had happened to him. I've experienced some issues myself in previous races and have a bit of a history of cardiac issues and so on. So I was kind of curious as to was desperate to know really what had actually been involved in his death. And I found out, and I talked to you, didn't I, when I did find out?
Yeah, you did.
Because I was sort of a bit torn as to whether we should talk about it and whether I should do a story about it in my other life, because I felt it was important for people to know, but I was also sort of torn as a sort of a warning, but I was also torn about, you know, the privacy issues and also not wanting to offend anyone or worry anyone necessarily. But thank you for having that chat with me that day, Matt, because I think it helped me arrive at a place that we needed to get to. Yeah.
And I think it's I guess with everything and thinking about risk and thinking about how it's unavoidable in our lives, right?
Mm.
You didn't write it from a tone of sensationalism, nor were you judging. And I imagine there would have been some sensitivity around that from certain quarters.
Yeah.
Or potential sensitivity. And also, you know, you're not an outsider. I mean, you ran that race too. And there by the grace of God, you know, you finished that race.
Yeah.
And I think it is. It's important to talk about this stuff. The sport that we do is has potential side effects, and it takes a lot out of people. I mean, I was talking to my friend just before who he's just started running, and he got his 10K PB today, and he was so happy and talked about how he'd read your work and, you know, that stuff. And just that line that you said is, you know, the 100K isn't the new half marathon.
Yeah, well, that was...
Words to that effect. That's sports doctor.
Yeah, Dr. Tom Reynolds, who's the Tarawera doctor, who I was really grateful, who, you know, he talked to me.
Yeah.
Generally, he of course couldn't talk about the the patient for obvious reasons, but he was happy to talk to me about the sort of safety aspects and what goes on in a race. And so, yeah, he talked about there's a danger of people trying to see 100Ks as if they're the new half marathon, and they're certainly not. But, yeah, so just sort of cutting to the chase, really. So there was three things listed on the death certificate: multi-organ failure and respiratory distress, which are potential signs of a bunch of problems. But the other thing that was listed on there was rhabdo, and I'm going to get you as the medical expert to say it properly.
Rhabdomyolysis.
There you go. Which is a muscle breakdown. So it basically, your muscles break down, don't they?
Hmm. I mean, I'm terrible at this. Like, so as I understand it, my understanding is not much more than a layperson. So I understand that your muscles break down and you basically start to process your own protein, and that's not so good for the kidneys.
Yeah. And yeah, so basically the protein cells are in the bloodstream, and people can get mild versions of it.
Mm.
I think some of the testing that Tom Reynolds was saying was done at, there was a study at Western States a few years ago, and there's a marker that they look for in your blood tests, and basically everyone they tested was over the limit for what you would normally expect when you're trying to pick up something like rhabdo.
Do you know what that marker was? Was it C-reactive protein, or was it creatinine kinase?
Yes, CK, I think.
Yeah, yep. Creatinine kinase. So that's a sign of muscle breakdown. So,
yep.
I mean, if you get in a fight or have an injection or fall down the stairs or, you know, do anything like that, it can raise your CK levels because it's the – but, yeah, anyone who runs an ultramarathon, you're going to be looking at that sort of – or anyone who runs at all at times, you're going to be looking at that.
That whole thing of a couple of days after the race, you still can't – it's still difficult sitting down and standing back up again.
Oh, geez.
All that sort of stuff. But obviously what had gone on here was a very extreme case. In fact, there hasn't been any recorded deaths from it from runners anywhere else in the world before. I spoke to Marty Hoffman, who is UC Davis, and he hadn't heard of any previous. He sort of keeps a watch on deaths and ultra races. He came out to Tarawera a couple of years ago, actually did some research, and he hadn't heard of it happening before in a runner. Mm. He got an extreme version of rhabdo, and it's like I was saying, that it's hard to spot because it's, some of the symptoms are muscle tenderness, confusion. Well, that can be the same as having run 100 miler, might be what you expect. Another thing is Dr. Reynolds talked about Coca-Cola coloured urine, this brown urine. But again, if you're at nighttime, you're in a port-a-loo, you might not even spot it.
Yeah.
Or you might think you've got it, but you haven't. So it's really, really tricky. And I guess if there's any, the takeaways for me were, let's look out for each other.
Absolutely.
When we're out there on the course and when we're running, let's look out for our mates. Let's look out for the people around us. If you see someone who is confused and distressed, then just make sure they're okay. Maybe mention it to aid station staff and so on.
Yeah, to Marshall or something like that.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. Don't do anything like take non-steroidal blah, 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 blahs, ibuprofen and so on.
No, please don't.
Please do not. And I like how they're getting even stronger about that in races, aren't they? I've seen at Kepler and Tarawera briefings, them saying basically you're going to be banned if you take those. Drink to thirst. Some of those things that we know that we should do, we've just got to do them, don't we? Because sometimes we get a bit slack. And yeah, let's be careful out there, people.
And that's the thing, I guess, as well, isn't it? We're coming into our big season soon. So we've got Kepler, and then it'll be Tarawera, and then it's Northburn, and then, all Gold Coast, all those other races. And we just need to generally just look after each other.
Yeah, definitely. And I asked Tom Reynolds, I said, well, hey, you know, because we talked about that, we had this really quite dark conversation. And I said to him, you know, look, after all you've said, do you recommend people run ultra marathons? And he said, look, you know, when it's 3 a.m. and we've got a backed up medical tent, you know, sometimes I wonder what the hell is everyone doing? But look, he says, look, we're talking about a relatively small proportion. Mm. And with the right preparation, the right training, a bit of knowledge, you can do this stuff safely.
Absolutely.
But one thing is to know the risks, you know, that they don't, it's not just a linear increase of risks. So that's why he's saying don't, you know, think of the 100K as the new half marathon. It's not. You've got to take the steps to get there, prepare properly, make sure you're ready, make sure your body is, you know, can read the signs and cope with these things. So, yeah, anyway, that's what we wanted to pass on to you.
And beautifully written too, I must say.
Oh, thank you. It was a tough one. Anyway, look, after last week's long list of races, it was fairly quiet over the weekend.
But we had some great feedback.
And,
so we put out a call to action last week. We're like, get in touch. Do you like the races? Do you not like the races? And people said yes and, didn't they? They said, yes, we like the races.
Yep.
And, you know, sometimes it can feel like a bit of a laundry list. But so we're going to work on that and try and find a good balance. But, yeah, like you said, it was quiet over the weekend.
Yeah. Yeah. There was a couple of local races, Gully Gut Bus, for instance, at Paparangi, just north of Wellington. They look quite fun. The Homestead Bay Run at Queenstown looked like a bit of a blat. And there was the Long Beach Coastal Classic in Mid-Canterbury that had a mix of events. And there was a few others that I saw around, but generally pretty quiet. So, I mean, it's ramping up for Kepler next week. And some of the big guns are lining up, aren't they?
Yeah. I mean, and this is the thing. It's going to be an all people living here affair.
Yes.
So, you know, Dan Jones is looking for a three-peat. He's been in some great form. He might even wear trail shoes this time. I don't know. Vajan Armstrong, who's, you know, he's done the race so many times and won it and podium so many times, he can never be counted out. Silas Carey, Devin Beckman, Christian Day, Matthew Gummer, Chris Lyons and Will O'Connor all in it to really grab it by the scruff of the neck. You know?
Yeah, definitely. Is that Rigby chipping in?
It is. Thanks, Rigby.
Thanks, Rigby. And the women's, I mean, wow. You know, Ruby Muir, 6 times champion. Another previous champion, Nancy Zhang. She's lining up again. It's going to be a race to watch for amongst, you know, watch there, isn't it? And you got to wonder, is the course record not the threat this year? You know,
I hope so.
Abby Padgell is going to be there too. You know, in the grunt, there's some really interesting names. Dwight Grieve, the local legend. He's done 10 Keplers, but he's having his first crack at the grunt.
Sam Manson, Jonah Jackson. That's going to be mad.
It's going to be crazy.
So good.
Yeah, I'm going to definitely have to keep left.
Yeah.
Or else I'm going to cop an elbow.
You're going to have to give it the moose call too.
Oh, I will. Definitely.
Yeah,
definitely.
You should.
Yeah, I will. I will.
And then the woman, Sarah Douglas, I mean, she's so classy.
Mm.
Sabrina Grogan and Aisa Shafi. It's going to be epic. I can't wait.
Yeah.
And, I mean, we talked about the records, but they're long-standing records. So the current race record is held by Martin Dent in a time of 4:33.37. And this was way back in 2013. And that was that record held since 2005, and that was set by Phil Costley. And in the women's, the current race record is held by Zella Morrell in a time of 5:23.34, which was set in 2003.
Wow.
And Ruby's come super close to that record a couple of times.
Yeah.
So,
so it's a 17-year-old record. Good maths here, right?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, wow. That's, you know, I think if there's good race conditions, and obviously the competition is there, so bring it on.
Yeah, 100.
Yeah. Mm. Right.
Greatest run ever, which is the part of the show where we ask you to write into us and tell us your greatest run ever. It doesn't have to be a race or a mountain summit. Might just be a run around the block or that time you won Kepler 6 times. Something that sung to you for some reason. You could send it in to us at dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. And Ruby Muir is never going to send us in a greatest run ever.
I bet that won't be landing in our inbox.
Yeah. A little over 2 years.
I'll just check.
No. It's from Kerry Williams. So a little over 2 years ago, at the age of 49, I started my running journey. After decades of saying, this body doesn't do running, I attempted to start. And I failed dismally. Pulled calf, sore ankles, etc., etc., etc. But with a good physio and better shoes, I persisted. About 8 months into the journey, I met two inspirational women, and this is where my greatest run ever begins. Paula Culling Brown. I don't know if I can say this.
I don't know. Maybe not.
Who's got quite an unsavoury nickname, her father affectionately calls her, and Amy Sutherland were two bluff women on a mission.
I mean, Paula sounds really bad, actually.
So her dad calls her Paula Stinkbum, but there you go.
Yeah, all right.
And Amy Sutherland were two bluff women on a mission. Paula had lost 25 kilos and made herself at home running Bluff Hill on a regular basis. She competed in a couple of half marathons, and Amy had talked her into running the Luxmore Grunt. Amy was rehabilitating after an accident that saw her shatter her heels and was told that she would never run again. Oof. I guess this is one of those times when you never say never to someone. Amy had got a place on the Kepler in 2019. It would be her third time. Amy's from running pedigree. Her father, Neil Sub Sutherland, a veteran of 20-plus Keplers, and her brother, Craig, had completed in multiple Keplers and was returning from Canada to complete in 2019. I joined Amy and Paula on their training runs around Bluff Hill, often in the cold and dark with head torches. Every day is different on the Bluff Hill, and the sights and sounds of the bush would make it a great day to be out running. As well as the tunes from the beautiful bellbirds, Tui and Kedadu, we'd come across Moorpork and keep our eye out for whales off the coast.
Wow.
As the training and talk of Kepler continued, I knew I wanted to be there on race day for my friends, so I offered to pace the ladies for the end of their races. As you know, it had rained epically. Yes, we're aware of that. Thank you. And the normally beautiful fjordland forest had been transformed into a river flowing through some of the lower parts of the course, a glacially cold river. The morning of Kepler dawned with more heavy rain.
Well, they're from Bluff, so.
Yeah, true. Actually, sorry. Just a river.
Just for us Aucklanders, sorry.
Actually, it's just a bath. It's how I run my bath. Amy.
Just for us soft Aucklanders. Anyway,
that's right.
Sorry.
It's too cold. Amy had started and I dropped Paula off at the start of the grunt. Pre-race nerves were happening. I knew she'd trained well and would be awesome. In true Paula style, she took her snorkel and goggles in her pack and got a photo at Luxmore Hut with the volunteers.
From there,
she texted me and I started making my way towards Broadbay to meet her. This is where I became so inspired. Walking in or wading in, I was meeting all the Kepler and grunt runners coming my way and I was able to clap and cheer them on. I met Amy about Dock Bay and gave her a hug, told her that she was amazing and that her mum was just up ahead. She said she was dying, but I could tell from the determination on her face that she was going to do it. Truly motivation was a vision-impaired runner being guided along with two pacers. I came across the elite and not-so-elite and all running their own race. I carried on through Broad Bay, up the hill, and met Paula hurtling down the slippery, muddy track at great speed. She stopped at Broad Bay for some nutrition, and we headed back towards the control gates. Her calves didn't enjoy the transition from downhill to flatter terrain, and we stopped to work out some pain points. I was impressed by the consideration shown by other runners as they inquired if we were okay. Paula had one last kick in her as she raced across the control gates, across the finish line, and into the arms of a hugely supportive family, cheering her on as she finished. I admired her strength and tenacity, hugely proud of all her hard work and achievements at the floodgates, and my eyes burst open with admiration. After a short celebration with Paula, her husband Clint took me through to Rainbow Reach, where I waited for Amy. God, she's into it, isn't she? Mm. Here I could see firsthand the amazing work by all the volunteers at the aid stations and the enthusiasm and positivity they put into supporting the athletes. Amy came through at a power walking, almost running pace and warned me of the water that lay ahead. Her partner Will was supporting her. She was physically hurting but mentally strong. With the end in sight, she powered along, trying to chase down whomever was ahead of her. The last 5K in and out of that water that had escaped the Waia River was hard. In some places, it was only ankle deep, and in parts, there was no clear track. We all ended up chest deep, paddling and scrambling to feel the ground underneath our feet. Amy powered on. You can hear the finish line about 2 kilometres out. You can, can't you? And it sounds close, and the motivation and determination to get it done was clear. As Amy crossed the line, her dad had the honour of placing the finishing medal around her neck. There was no holding back the floodgates then. My running buddies ran with heart and determination. I'm so immensely grateful to have them as friends. My love for trail running was cemented that day, and the beautiful understanding that everyone has their own personal journey at the start line and their own race to run. Run happy.
Wow.
That's beautiful.
That's and beautiful, it's beautiful, Kerry.
Because her greatest run ever was more about two other people that she was supporting than herself.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think in the email, I should have checked this, but she said that Paula's going back this year.
Amazing.
Yeah, well done. Thanks, Kerry.
Come say hi.
Yeah. The rest of you, send them in. We love we hearing them, and people love hearing them. So, yeah, do that. All right. Hanny Allston, she is a performance coach and business owner of Find Your Feet Australia. She's a past world champion orienteering athlete. She's a trail and ultra runner and adventurer. In 2019, she spontaneously, just because you can, ran the length of the French Pyrenees Mountains in 19 days. And we talk all about that.
As you do.
Yep. Now she's an author, having recently released Finding My Feet. I did enjoy this conversation. Thank you very much and enjoy it. Here is Hanny. Church Radio. Joining us on the line from Tasmania, our Australian cousins, is Hanny Allston. Welcome to the show.
Thanks, Eugene. It's awesome to be here. Oh, such an honor.
We're so excited to have you. You know, and we were just talking. I've just done a speed read of Finding My Feet, and I just wanted to say congratulations on such a very raw and brave and a book that lots of people need to read to hear that message that you impart. So thank you.
Yeah, no, thank you so much. I'm very impressed that you've read that quickly. But yeah, I guess like to touch on that, like I just wanted to write that book that, you know, in some ways I wish I'd been there when I'd been going through some of the tougher times and also some of the amazing times on my own journey. Obviously I'm only 34, but you know, there's been some big highs, big lows and everything in the middle. And I just think there's such a power in having that me too moment, you know, when someone comes up and goes, oh, me too. And you just get this wave of almost relief wash over you and power that comes from understanding that your experience is just part of the greater human experience. And so it's been really interesting to see the variety of lives that the book is touching. And I'm so grateful for so many of the readers holding such a safe space to share the journey, because there was a fear in being that vulnerable when I wrote the book and released it.
That's right. There's that sort of the fear of vulnerability is built into us, isn't it? And it's something you deal with as well, but you had the courage to sort of step out there and tell your story.
Yeah. I think that is very true, but you know, as you know, in the book, like I touch on athleticism, on mental health, on growing up as a young woman and so many more topics. And, you know, I think that there are so many things that we probably aren't talking enough about. And one of the areas that I'm extremely, I hate the word passionate, but I need to use it in this sense, but passionate about is ensuring that when we are chasing our big dreams, whether they're athletic or not, that we're not doing it to the detriment of health, well-being, joy, love, and relationships. And I really believe now, thanks to experience and understanding that's come later in my athletic journey and also my business and career journey, is that it is possible to succeed on the higher stages, but also in a state of optimal well-being, and I call it thriving. So I want to really write strongly, openly about the hard times so that it almost like emphasized the great times and the experiences I've had recently.
And there's a bit that I wanted to, I mean, I'm not going to spend the whole chat quoting back at you, but there's a philosophy which you express in the book, which is that you've come to believe that when you're faced with no other option than to overcome adversity, we can rise to perform at our best. In this moment, our ego has been stripped away to reveal the humility that can now breathe life into patience and deep carefulness. When we remove the ego and pressure of personal or external expectations, we are only left with opportunity. You don't arrive at that place easily, but it's a place that you needed to get to.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I touch on topics like suicide and body image and overtraining and huge injury that was threatening my running career and just losing myself in all of that. But I would never, ever change that journey for the world, because I think I really mean that. Like when you go to those really challenging places, it uncovers a side to you and also the values that you hold deep in you that maybe you haven't yet come to realize. And as you go on that understanding of who you are, I think it's almost catalyzed by challenge, adversity, that journey. I think you can get there without it, but it just takes a whole lot longer and a whole lot more perseverance. And yeah, so I feel like the challenges that I went through have really helped me to kind of really rise to who I am now.
Mm.
And I think that our greatest champions, whether they're in sport or business or life, and I think that so many of them have faced huge adversity. And you look at the Olympic champions and how many have risen through adversity. And yeah, so I just think that often change, we turn away from change because, you know, there's such a stability in our normal routines and our world that we live in. But adversity does force you to change. And that's the case that comes. Mm. Yeah.
Mm, absolutely. Can we talk a little bit about your childhood? Because it's, you know, you describe it as a paradise, really, a childhood paradise for your brother and your friends, and who you described as the famous five. It does sound wonderful. Lots of camping and adventures. It sounds fantastic.
Yeah, I mean, growing up, I grew up on a 12-acre hobby farm south of Hobart, and probably not too dissimilar to what so many New Zealand children grow up with. And yeah, I just think that I already had this wild spirit in me. I think then it was bred into me by the landscape around us. And I had parents that were willing to place a lot of trust in us. And I was very aware of that, I think, always, that I knew that I would allow my impish spirit to breathe, but I knew never to let it cross the border of trust with the parents, so that... Yeah, I just had this feeling that at some point I would need to rely on that trust, which I did come to as I began to get into orienteering and to be gifted opportunities to travel all over the world. And so by the age of 15, 16, I was a young, blonde, small female traveling solo around the world to countries like Estonia on parental trust. So, yeah, that childhood, I think, was such a critical part of, like, fostering who I am today. And I feel really blessed because my husband and I have been able to somewhat recreate that setting for our own child, you know, soon on the way. Because I just think that there's something very special about growing up with your hands in the earth or on the earth.
It really is special, isn't it? And yeah, I hadn't thought of it in those terms of imbuing that sense of trust as well as that whole, the sort of wild side of it, but just, yeah, that sense of trust that you grow up with and courage and being brave enough to be able to go off and travel around the world when you were so young and so on. It comes from there, doesn't it, really?
It does, because, you know, from, you know, well under the age of 10, you know, I was just thrown out the door at 6-7 in the morning after breakfast and told to be back by dinner time. And we had such a huge range, wild space to roam around. And, you know, often we would just bundle in the door at 5 minutes to 6 covered in blackberry scratches. And the parents didn't question what trouble we'd been up to as long as they knew we really hadn't crossed too many boundaries. So, yeah, special.
And yet sort of the flip side of that sort of wild side to you, and that you know, was you were so firm with your goals, and you even wrote them down to be an Olympian, to live at AIS and become a doctor. Where do you think that desire to be so fixed on those goals at such a young age came from?
It's certainly not a competitive drive. I think I've come to recognize that now. It's taken a long time to understand that. I just have always been one of these people that wants to make sure I make the most of this life, that I see my best potential. And they always say your greatest gift is your greatest curse. I definitely think that inner drive, that, you know, very much an internal drive, is what allowed me to reach the highs that I've reached, particularly in my athleticism. But it is also your greatest curse. I think it was the thing that has probably tipped me over the edge at times and into the, you know, stretching too far, too fast. But, you know, I have parents that are very, you know, that lean in really hard to life as well. And I also think that I wouldn't say it was parental pressure, but they definitely wanted the most out of us.
Yeah.
That we would come away satisfied with our performance or our homework or whatever it was that we were working on. So I think it's a combination of a lot of things, really.
And, you know, your swimming came about through your mum's. She sounds like a formidable swimmer herself, an amazing swimmer. And she would take you off to go swimming from an early age. So setting that example there and being the supportive parent, I guess, from that early age helps as well, doesn't it? Sets routines and those sorts of things.
It really does. I mean, I was, somewhat thrown in the pool by the age of seven, but to be honest, I really did love it. I am still a bit of a water baby, not quite to the same sense, but my mum wasn't the sort of woman to just sit on the side and cheer and clap and, you know, wrap the towel around you when you finish. She'd be in there too, whether she was doing her own laps next in the lanes next to us or even somewhat competing in the masters competitions at other alternate weekends. And so I think I, you know, always looked up to her and the way she applied herself to everything, not to mention the fact that my parents did everything from scratch on the farm down to, you know, milking the cow and collecting the eggs and baking the bread and making the butter. And, you know, so they worked incredibly hard there. And then they both were full time as a doctor and a lawyer in the government. So, you know, there was, I guess you just grew up not knowing any different to apply yourself to what you did. And the pool setting is very regimented, so it definitely sort of instilled that even further.
That whole work ethic, just you become imbued with it, I suppose.
Yeah.
But, I mean, swimming, the way you describe it and those early successes that you had and so on and your desire for it, but, gosh, there was a side to it that was – it just sounds ugly – and can't have been easy as a kid, and kids can be so cruel, can't they?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I think my brother and I always knew we were different. I now look at difference as a beauty, as a godsend. I think everyone is different, but when you embrace your individuality and your uniqueness, your authenticity, I think there's such a strength in that. But you know, it's hard to see that when you're that 11, 12, 13-year-old growing up with the boys that would torment you. My nickname, as I said, was Bush Pig or Thomas the Tank Engine because I was built like a brick shit house in swimming days. And, you know, so it wasn't an easy environment. And then to add further fuel to those flames, we had coaches that were always seeking that 1%. And you know, we were a very talented squad. You know, we had athletes making Australian teams and vying for Olympic selection and heading off to the World Championships. But, you know, sometimes we go too far in our strive for performance, and I think we did cross that. So at the age of 13, we were skinfold tested every week. We were weighed in before sessions. We were in the gym from the age of 12, and I just think that it was a bit of a storm brewing for so many of us that were already really driven and already incredibly careful with the way we approached our endeavours. And so that environment sort of, it went from being free and flowing like the water to being something that I was quite fearful of. And I just got to the point where I wasn't loving it. I couldn't recognize it, but deep down I wasn't loving it. I was feeling a lot of pressure.
Yeah. And that whole pressure that came from your coaches and I guess too the taunts that you would get and everything, it kind of builds, doesn't it? And I mean, without giving any too much away in the book, it sort of comes through in the end that you had this friend, anorexia, who came and to be part of your life, part of your story. And it's a complex story and one that isn't easy to talk about.
No, definitely not. And I think it took me a long time to actually be able to say, you know, like I have had anorexia. But I just think that, you know, that time was just such a tipping point, even though I didn't recognize it at the time, because what happens when you fall out of love with something, I think you'll know this from surely your story too, that it plateaus your performance. It makes it harder to just apply and to let yourself go and be free and just dive into the pool and race hard and with a love in your heart and that fierce spirit. And so as you plateau, and also too for me that came in a really pivotal time of puberty, which tends to make that plateau happen naturally anyway for so many women and boys. was that I would read a lack of performance or not performing as I'm not good enough, I'm not fit enough, I haven't applied myself enough. And so you dig harder. And what ends up happening is you begin just digging a really deep hole. And so it wasn't until I sidestepped out of swimming into the sport of orienteering that I just like went, oh my gosh, you know, I actually went to New Zealand on my first trip over there. And it was just so freeing, so liberating. Yeah. It was like none of this shave your legs and be in bed at eight and eat your pasta and have your nana nap in the afternoon. It was like chase the boys through the wheat fields at, you know, midnight and still get up the next day and race really well. And I just was like, oh my gosh, this is loving something. And so anorexia was able to stay in bed for a very, very long while. It wasn't until sort of later on that it really came to manifest.
So it was sort of that love of orienteering really helped you. I mean, and you're right at that moment in Auckland that reinforced that switch from swimmer to orienteer, that it became something that you loved and you were good at and you could be yourself a bit more maybe?
Yeah. Yeah, I think I found a tribe that I really belonged in. I went from, you know, my world being somewhat small and limited to the life on the farm and Tassie, which is a very small pond, to, you know, travel, like opportunities to travel the world and make friends all over the world. And no one knew my past. And here I was, it was like a fresh start and I was good at it. I have somewhat of like a memory for landscapes and maps and interpreting a lot of information really quickly. And so I think that combined with this huge fitness base that I'd built since I was seven, I just started to flourish. I'm not saying I was naturally great off the bat. I had a tendency to make massive errors, but I think one thing I do also have as a gift is an ability to look past the result that gets put on the wall at the end of a performance, but to break it down and to see the fine small strengths, the little glimmers of hope that go, well, that, isn't that interesting? If I was to do that like 90% of the time, not 70% of the time, then what would be possible? So I began to kind of break down my performance and seek out the best coaches in Australia to help me with things and to just trial and error. And yeah, I applied myself to it and began to see the the results.
Well, you sure did. I mean, you know, a world champ as a junior and a senior, you know, phenomenal success.
Yeah. And I never sort of set out for it all to happen that quickly. I mean, obviously junior, you have a time limit, but as you know, I'm sure you've now read about in the book, like I went through this perfect storm of huge hardship and adversity in my final year leading up to my final year of the junior world titles. And, you know, I had a full ankle reconstruction where they said I'd probably never run again. A father who attempted suicide and was hospitalized for a long period of time. I was at med school and was trying to sit all my final exams. And I just saw myself in, to be honest, in this big hole. And I just felt that maybe if I could just get to the top of that world tree, something I'd dreamed about now for quite a long time, it would help me to feel like I'd climbed out of this hole. And so I just leaned in really hard into that goal. And so the senior world titles, which resulted 2 weeks after winning the junior worlds in Lithuania, were quite a surprise. But I was just saying to an audience today that I have no memory of that senior title win, like very little.
Wow.
I just remember not I was by that stage I saw myself as a long distance specialist, and this was actually a sprint distance race, and the selectors had been adamant that they needed me to run it, and because I didn't want to be there, like I couldn't find the purpose in being there, and I'd begun to learn that purpose helped performance, I was like, well, I need to give this race meaning. So I ran it for my father. So I don't have any memory really of the race. I just have memory of this absolute connection with it, this dedication to it, this almost like flow state run. As a result of it, I won the senior world titles too in Denmark that year.
What do you mean by the the flow state. It's something that we all sort of as runners strive for, but it's just so hard to capture. I can't imagine it's any easier when you had so much going on in your head, but you're making it sound like it was because of that that you were able to discover the flow state.
I think so. And I think the only way I can, like, this is not out of a textbook. This is Hanny's interpretation of the flow state. But it's only, I think I've only discovered this since last year when I ran the French Pyrenees. And maybe I'm jumping ahead, but last year I had this glorious opportunity to spend 3 weeks very spontaneously, as in, like, within 2 days of, like, really having the opportunity. I was standing at the start of the Pyrenees up on the Atlantic coastline staring down this trail called the GR10, which is about, well, I don't know, it's anywhere from 700 to 900 kilometers depending on who measures it, but I got closer to 900k. And I ended up running solo for 19 days through the mountains. My husband was my support crew, and we hadn't really had any holiday break for, oh my god, like, I don't know, like, a very long time, probably in our entire relationship time. And we hadn't had a honeymoon either after our wedding because we were too busy coaching other junior competitors overseas and leading our tours internationally. So here I was, I'm running for 3 weeks down the Pyrenees while he's driving a car supporting me. And at first this challenge seemed like it was a very physical challenge. It's like, right, I just have to run. It's about 45K a day. If I just run 45K a day over this many days, then I'll get to the end. A few days in, it beat me up and spat me out. I was so sore and so broken. And at that point, it became very mental. I was like, oh, my God, like, how do I do this? What do I eat? How many hours should I sleep? Do I do self-massage? Should I be going for a walk for recovery? And I just spent like a week caught up in my own head, and it was so noisy. You know, just churning thoughts all the time, trail, day, night as well. And then about a week and a half in, or maybe a week in, it became really emotional. It was like so much guilt. And then I'd be like so guilty because my poor husband is driving around in like a shit bomb, navigating these tiny roads. And here I am running freely through the mountains. And then I'd get to this like hilltop or this mountaintop, and I'd just suddenly hit this massive high, and I'd be whooping and I'd be singing down the hill. And then I'd get to dinner time and I'd be tired and I'd be exhausted and I'd be crying because I felt guilty again. And it was this emotional roller coaster. And then eventually, after about 2 weeks in, that passed as well. And I just hit this, like, I can't describe it any other way. It was like super quiet state. It was like the body had gone quiet, the thoughts had gone quiet, the emotions had gone quiet. And I call it like a spiritual state. And I think that's why people get so addicted to like big adventures and expeditions and big races, because every now and then you reach that point. And I pretty much spent a week like running through the mountains just in total Zen mode. And I, I kept, you know, dreaming about reaching the ocean at the end. And I pictured these blue turquoise Mediterranean water that I would finally get there, and there'd be this sandy beach and I'd dive in and the water would be balmy. And I kept wondering, like, what will be the reaction, you know, after such a long period of time on the trail. And I got there and the beach was grey and rocky and the water was bloody freezing. And I didn't feel like swimming. And I just sat down on the beach and I just didn't feel anything. I'd sort of imagined that I would maybe cry or laugh or high-five my husband and give him a big hug, but it was just Zen. And so I go back to the World Championships and you ask, like, what's the flow state? And I look at my it was a completely different time, you know, I'm only racing for 30 minutes in a sprint, but physically I was so prepared. Mentally, I'd just come out of the junior world titles. I knew what it took to put performance together. So I just switched into, you know, the right tools of my trade. Emotionally, I was charged. I mean, I was running for my father. Mm. And I think when you put those three together and you allow them to be processed, you just hit this like spiritual flow state. I think what when it goes wrong is when you try too hard.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Or when you put an extra emotion that you can't get rid of, like expectation, on top of you, and then that will disrupt the flow state. But if you're willing just to take a big step back and go, I've done the physical work, I have the mental tools, you know, I'm in a great emotional state, then that spiritual moment will come. So that's my definition of the flow state, and a long way to get there. But I think it's like a real aha moment for me.
Yeah. And isn't it interesting that in both those scenarios that you describe, the world championship and that getting, you know, making it to the end of the Pyrenees, that there's not sort of a, I mean, you'd say that you can't even remember much about the world championship title, and that when you reached the Pyrenees, it was just sort of not the big moment that you thought it would be. So it's like this flow state spiritual moment doesn't have to lead to a big, you know, choirs of angels and harpsichords or anything.
Totally. And I mean, I think I look at, you know, I always get introduced as, you know, world champion or record holder, you know, all those titles. But I think about my greatest performances, the ones that I'm the most proud of. And they're the quiet moments. And they're the moments when I truly, honestly was just being me, and unapologetically so. And I think that it has been an awareness of that that's really helped me to find myself.
Mm.
Yeah.
Can we just go back to that scene that you describe so powerfully in your prologue, where you're faced with some of life's most painful moments, but you have to make a decision. Well, you do make a decision to find a way out of that hole.
Mm.
Can you just, in as much detail as you want to, describe a bit more of that scene for us and what it was, and tell us what it was that made you decide, I'm going to climb out of here?
Yeah. So like I said, I mean, I had had this ankle reconstruction. I was 19 and I was told that I would never run again, which is pretty hard to hear when you just found a sport that you just had fallen in love with and you had felt like this gift had been given to you, but you weren't ever going to fully realize it. So I was still processing that. I think I was quite a lot in denial. I was training on my crutches, and as you do. And then it was a few weeks into that journey that my father had a huge bipolar episode out of the blue. I mean, I'd always known that there was this history somewhere deep in there in our family, but it'd always been closed doors. You know, I was a child and we shield our children from pain like that.
Mm.
And then I was suddenly the one there at the time, and he went missing and attempted suicide, and it resulted in huge burns and he was in ICU. And so the next day after this incident was my first opportunity to go in and see him. And I went in and he just was looking at me and just going like, I'm sorry. And I just stopped him and said, Dad, like, it's okay. Because now, like, we can move forward with honesty. And I think that it was the pivotal moment for me, because I think until then, maybe, like, I wasn't always being honest with myself too about my dreams and what I really wanted. And, you know, I was always trying to maybe still, like, fit in with the crowd a little. And I knew that my parents, you know, had things that they needed to kind of work through. And I just truly in my heart believed that the way out of that hole was just to lean into what we love and to chase it unapologetically. And so that was the decision I made. And I think the corollary to the story is that when I did win my world title and I got on the plane to come home, it was just, I just had this huge wake up call that success hadn't changed me, and that I was still Hanny, and I still had to come home to all of the same challenges of which I'd left, you know, to head over there. And that was such a big lesson for a 20-year-old, was absolutely just understand that it's beautiful to succeed. It's incredible. It's amazing to be gifted the highest accolades in your sport, but it will never change who you are as an individual, and you need to be able to peel off your racing kit and put your PJs on at the end of the day and just be so proud to walk in your own shoes. Mm-hmm. And it was a good, I think it was a great lesson to learn at that age.
A really tough one, but, you know, that's right. Becoming world champion doesn't flick a switch in your life, does it? It's still your life.
Yeah, and it's the same is true for anything, you know. You know, we strive for our businesses succeeding. We strive to climb career ladders or become parents or what, you know, we have dreams, but we have to just realize that it's so cliche, but it's so true. Like, it is that journey to getting there that is the defining pivotal moment. It's not the end result. And so, yeah, I think, like, it's for me made it easier to kind of lean in the tough times and into my dreams without feeling like I'm riding on it all going to plan.
Yeah. And you write too about some advice for your younger self about patience. That's something that's hard to learn as well, isn't it?
I don't have patience. I still don't.
Oh, so you should have written to yourself self, not your younger self.
I'm trying to learn, Eugene. I just was always in a hurry. I had some beautiful friends around me that just stuck with things a bit longer, and eventually rose to the top. And I think rather than like trying to get there quickly and digging holes or, you know, ending up on shaky grounds, like they've really created a strong sense of self and really learnt to love what they loved, and then they added the elements of performance on top of that. And the concept of patience has probably really led me to my number one motto in life, which is grow, play, perform wilder. About who am I and understanding who you are, that's the growing wilder. And then play wild's about learning to love what you love and chase that unapologetically. And I think that when you have that foundation of understanding of self, then you have this thing that you love that you like pursuing, then you can add the art of performance on top of that. And I just think that I was always in such a hurry that I wanted to jump straight to the top of the little pyramid and perform, you know. And I was so focused then on nutrition and training and strength training and recovery and just never really gifting myself enough time to really, I don't know, pause and get to know myself, especially for that perfect storm.
Yeah. You, in your coaching philosophy, you talk about being wilder, and you just mentioned wilder then, but I just wonder what you mean by that. What does being wilder mean to you?
I think it's just about daring to lean in and then also lean out of the box, you know, daring to, I think there's so much that we learn intuitively from ourselves. And, you know, if I take an example, like the Australian model of distance training for running is you do your easy day on Monday, you do your hard day of intervals on Tuesday, you do your semi-long run Wednesday, you do your intervals on Thursday, you have a day off on Friday, you do something hard like a race on a Saturday, and you do your long run Sunday, full stop, repeat. And I guess being wilder to me is about going, well, that's interesting. Does that suit my lifestyle? I don't know. I've got a little one on the way. Is that going to work in a year's time? Like, oh, that injury, it's probably asking me to back off a bit. You know what? I actually prefer mountains. So why would I go and run on the track on Tuesday if I really love being in the mountains? You know, it's like, it's about like going, that's interesting. What's another way? Is there a better way? I do it in business. I mean, being wilder in business to me is like, we've never had a marketing plan, really. We've certainly never had a business plan. And when COVID hit, thanks to not having plans, we had agility. In that moment, we went, well, this is an interesting time. What's a better way? What's a different way? What's going to allow us to flourish and help our community? Because gosh knows we all need help right now. So rather than going, focusing on the marketing plan, the business plan and making dollars, we went, how can we help you? And it saved us.
Yeah.
So I think like being wild is when all of that comes together, growing wild, playing wild, performing wild, and really just doing what you do best unapologetically.
Yeah, I guess taking that, nothing about nature is formulaic. You know, when you were running around the hills as a kid, you know, you were learning, weren't you, that it's not all about easy day Monday, reps on Tuesday, et cetera, et cetera, is it? It's life throws at you. So,
yeah.
Another thing that jumped out at the book, from the book at me, was your time in New Zealand, and you were coached by Barry McGee.
Yeah. I feel so blessed to have had that time. What a legend. That was really pivotal as well, and really important relationship for me, because as I said, I was on at the time a pathway to medicine, and I just panicked when I got back from that world champs, and life just felt really complex. Mm-hmm. Couldn't quite picture how medicine fitted in, and to be honest, all I wanted to do was just have a break. I was exhausted by that point. And I was in the spotlight. You know, I had journalists flying in from all over the world to just literally pursue me around Tassie for weeks on end, trying to understand, because at this point I was the only world champion from outside of Australia, outside of Europe, to win a title. And I think they were just curious to know what was in the water. So I felt like, yeah, I was just in the spotlight and unable to rest, and sadly, the uni wouldn't let me defer.
Yeah.
So I panicked and I hit cancel on medicine, moved to New Zealand, which was actually wonderful. And I studied primary school teaching. But what happened while I was in New Zealand was that my coach, he was more my mentor really than a coach, Max Cherry, who had just turned 80 and was as fit as a fiddle, but he had a huge heart attack at training and died. Mm. And I wasn't there. And I wasn't able to really grieve him, and nor was I able to really replace him. And it was at that time that I met Barry, and he just took me in under his wing and let me into his stable of incredible athletes. And he was also so playful, and wise, and had tools that I just never thought about before. And so, I think being there with Barry kind of really did further catapult me into the marathon running scene. Yeah.
Yeah, I could see how that happened with Barry. Yeah.
It came stronger.
Yeah, I had a bit of time coached by Barry as well. And he's an extremely special and dear, dear person, isn't he?
Yeah, very much so.
Mm. So tell me what running life is like in Tasmania. What is in the water in Tasmania? Because it does seem remarkable.
There's nothing in the water here. That's the beauty of it. You can go into it.
Yes, quite.
Yeah. I mean, in some ways we are like a condensed version of New Zealand.
Yeah.
We have the huge mountains. We have the beaches. We have the little intimate cities and towns, and then the agricultural scene too. I think for me, like, Tassie's an interesting place. I think it's a place you need to leave to love. You know, you grow up here and you're very sheltered from the world, COVID included, because we've been COVID free for most of this year. So we've just had the borders closed and just running amok. But you know, that's what it is like to grow up here. The terrain here is very, very challenging. It's true in pretty much every sport that I've competed in. The pools are slower, so when you get to nationals, you feel like you're flying when you're a swimmer. On the athletic scene, we have headwinds galore because we're in the roaring 40s, so you go to the mainland tracks and, again, you feel like you're flying. And then the trail, the orienteering scene, it's just dense. We've got a lot of vegetation and it's very complex mapping. So, yeah, you can go anywhere in the world and have confidence that you can, you know, lean into the challenges they throw at you. And then trail running, like, yeah, we have this very rough, rugged, remote terrain. And I really noticed that when we moved back about 5 years ago. And by this stage, I'd lived in Auckland, central Melbourne, and then Canberra for 5 years. And I thought Canberra kind of had a real natural scene to it, but when I came back to Tassie, I was pretty much beaten up and spat out the other end because the mountains here, you know, you drive like 3 hours to get out off into some of this really amazing terrain, and you're in the roaring 40s, the weather changes quickly, they're big slopes, the tracks are really rough, there's a lot of scrub sometimes, and if something goes wrong, you really notice that you're really on your own out there, and I wasn't really equipped for that, and so I began to kind of realize it's like having an adventure muscle, that if you use the muscle, it tends to kind of shrivel a bit, and that was what I was feeling when I came back from Canberra, was I was like, whoa. Oh my God, this muscle is not being used and it's not strong enough. And so it really took me quite a number of years of just chipping away and exposing myself to that terrain gently at first and then further and further afield to kind of really strengthen that adventure muscle and gain the confidence again to run in Tassie like I do now. Or have done.
I was having a look at some of the stats, like for instance, the Western Arthurs Traverse that you hold the FKT on, 10 hours, 30 minutes, 59 kilometres, 3,700 metres of vert. That's serious.
Yeah. The thing is, like, our tracks aren't like New Zealand. I mean, I loved living in New Zealand because there's so many trails and they're often so beautiful. You can really run, whereas things like the Western Arthurs is more like an obstacle course. It's wow. Up and under and down and scramble up and over and where the track goes. Like it's that sort of terrain.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. And Matt asked me to ask you about the loop that you get a sweet badge for running. If you come to your shop, can you tell us about that?
Oh, Wilder Trails.
Ooh. Yeah.
Yeah. This is funny. Like, I don't know if this happens to you, but I realize, like, if I look back through my life, there are so many things that started as this seed, like, a really long time ago. And then eventually, almost subconsciously, have just sort of manifested. And I now look at them and go, oh, geez, isn't that interesting? I had that idea like years ago and now we're doing it slightly differently, but we're doing it. And so Wilder Trails was something that I kind of had discussed, I reckon, when I was in my early 20s and running amok with some friends in Tassie. And the idea was that, you know, I mean, the idea more recently has come from coaching, and I get so many people go, you know, oh, I need a goal. So I want to enter a race. What race should I enter? Or I'm thinking about entering this race because I really need a goal. And yet then they come back and they're like, I'm like, yeah, how was it? And they go, yeah, it was good. I'm like, did you enjoy it? I don't know if it was my race. And the more I thought about it, the more I realized, like, racing isn't for everyone, you know, and maybe if it is for you, it's not for you all the time. And yet I think so we all need purpose. We all want things to look forward to. And I kept thinking about it, and I had this thought, yeah, like I say, years and years and years ago, wouldn't it be cool if there was like another way to have dreams and goals and challenges that weren't just about racing? So what we've done is we've created all these routes here in Tasmania, and every single route we hopefully give a really funky name. So things like Rock the Cradle and the Humbug, and they're all named with a sense of purpose to place. And then we've got a designer that we work alongside, and we create these really funky little badges and lapel pins that you collect when you've done the route. And so the idea is that we have levels for young, old, and beginner legs alike, and then sort of an intermediate level, and then like a really advanced level. So there's always something to strive towards. And the idea is we also want it to be a teaching platform, like a really holistic thing. So the platform has lots of information about, don't just go out the door tomorrow and like huff and puff and moan your way around it. Why not prepare for it for a few months or multiple months, maybe longer, and then go and thrive on it and come back weeping with joy, ready to collect your badge. So there's all this information there. And then the proceeds of the badges will go back into the not-for-profit sector to hopefully what we really want to do is to put it back into track conservation in Tasmania.
How brilliant.
Mm,
I love it.
So in the 5 months that we've had the program going, we've got over 700 people who've signed up to the Facebook group. But, I mean, we can sell like 20 badges a day at the moment. And it's just gorgeous. You have kids and families who've driven, you know, hell for leather down the east coast of Tassie from the route to get to the shop before it closes with their hair dripping and basically their badge. It's super cool. Yeah.
Oh, that must be so special.
It's really cool. Yeah.
Yeah, and I love the idea, like you say, it doesn't have to be about racing. You can have these other goals, these adventures and something to strive for.
Totally. And, you know, it's just when you see the diversity of people coming in. And, I mean, obviously we created thinking about trail running, but hikers and, I mean, the other weekend we had a couple in their 70s who were heading off to Cradle Mountain to do one of them. And it's given them a goal, and they would never have signed up to a race now. But they can sign up to this.
Oh, brilliant. Well, as soon as the borders are open, or one day when the borders are open, Matt and I will have to come over and bag ourselves a badge.
You would be so welcome.
Hanny, well, thank you so, so much for your time. I really, really appreciate it. And thank you again for the book. But I do need to ask you one more question. And it's one that we ask everyone who comes on the show. And that's, Hanny, what is your greatest run ever? Doesn't have to be a race or anything, world championship or anything, just a run that really sticks in your mind as special to you.
Yeah. Oh my God. I mean, there are four and I'm gonna let four. So I'm gonna pick the first one of the four. It was I ran it just before my final ever race in 2017. It's called the South Coast Track. So it's a trail that runs right around the southern coastline of Tasmania through the World Heritage Area. It's an eight-day hike. The idea is most people fly into one end and hike out to the other end and get picked up and drive 3 hours back to Hobart. So it just goes through these extraordinary ancient landscapes. It happens that the route used to be an Aboriginal trekking route to move from one tribe to another. And I had this opportunity, I dreamt of this opportunity to run it. And I think it was just the most freeing thing I've ever done, because once you start, you're completely in it. There's no way out. You've got 90 kilometres to get to the other end of this trail that's incredibly remote and requires a swim in the middle of it. And, and so I think, like, it was just this culmination for me of, like, when all of my skills and assets and tools and tricks and fitness and everything that I'd learned since childhood, I think, came together, and I just felt like I thrived out there. So, and I shared it with my best friends. So it was a super special run. I mean, I wouldn't recommend it for everyone, but it's a pretty amazing landscape to see.
Wow. With even the swim thrown in there as well. So everything from your whole upbringing.
Yeah, totally. Yeah.
Oh, how brilliant. That sounds amazing. And just having to give everything to make it.
Yeah.
Mm. Thank you so, so much for your time. I really, really appreciate it. And
Pleasure. Thank you.
Look forward to getting over and scoring one of those badges.
Yeah, you're welcome. And thanks for, like, reading that book. And I guess I can really feel the sense that you really did, like, think about it, you know, and hear it and hear what I was, I guess, hoping to share with the world. So thanks again for creating such a safe space for that and having me on the podcast. It's a joy.
Wonderful. Thank you. What a conversation. I like the idea she talks about having an adventure muscle, that you have an adventure muscle that you need to use, otherwise you forget about it.
Yes, absolutely.
And it's so true.
It's a beautiful way to put it.
Yeah.
It's a really beautiful way to put it.
And I also, you know, I'm looking forward to getting over there someday and running some of those trails.
Absolutely.
It feels like I need to exercise my adventure muscle before we go, though.
Damn right.
Yeah.
Look,
savage.
Thank you very much for tuning in. We're on social media at Dirt Church Radio. You can email us at dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. You can find us on iTunes, Spotify, Stitcher, and other podcast platforms. And you can download direct from the website, which is dirtchurchradio.com. And if we're not where you want us, let us know. Don't forget to subscribe and rate us. If you like what you see, spread the love. It would be great as many people heard the show as possible. And for that, we need your help.
Don't forget to write in with your greatest run ever.
Write in with your greatest run ever.
You come up to us at Kepler and say, oh, I must send it to you. We're going to make you sit down and write it there and then.
Yep. So, we've got pads.
Yep.
We're bringing refill. All right. Thanks to our sponsors, Scott Running, Further Faster and Spring Energy and Cielly. Thank you to our Patreon patrons and Wild Things. Thank you to our editor, Kieran. We've got great guests lined up for next week. Well, it'll be us next week and the live show next week. So super excited for that. If you're at Kepler and you see us hanging out, come say hi. We'd love to hang out. High five, socially distanced handshake, whatever you want to do. Yeah, just so excited to be getting away and getting amongst it. So we'll see you down there. Or tune in next week and ka kite.
Ka kite. Thanks, Rigby.